right now, so we'll call this meeting to order. We'll call the meeting of the Committee of the Whole open at 7:40 p.m. Adoption of the agenda. I move that the agenda be adopted as presented. Seconded by Councillor Lalonde. Any questions? Additions? None? Fine, thank you. All those in favor then? Yes, carried, thank you. Disclosures of pecuniary interests? None? Fine. Delegations, presentations? None? Questions? None? Well, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to ask that Town Council mandate Town Administration to modify bylaw with regards to street parking so that it might look closer to that street parking bylaw adopted by Ottawa and Gatineau. To wit, we prohibited parking overnight when we have snowfalls of 7 centimeters or more. At other times, though, overnight parking would be allowed, save and except for that provision. So would you like to come up with that bylaw? Just a question. We're talking about 7 centimeters, but our trucks, our snow clearing trucks, are called upon to go out and clear the streets at 5 centimeters. Well, the same rule applies to Ottawa and Gatineau. Well, if there are no sidewalks, of course, there might be a problem if there are cars parked alongside. Well, you know, sometimes, you know, they might advertise a 5 centimeter snowfall, but 10 centimeters fall. So then we run the risk of incurring major problems. Well, Mr. Mayor, we host about 12 events throughout the course of the year, maybe, where people would not be allowed over a 5-month period not to park on the street. It seems to me that if other municipalities are allowed to enact such provisions, the town of Gatineau is allowed to enact such provisions, well, you know, instead of setting it down at 7 centimeters, setting it down at 5 centimeters instead. Well, it's just a point I'd like to bring to your attention, you know, that all vehicles, snow clearing vehicles, are released at 5 centimeters, if you wish. They're given the green light to clear our snows and sidewalks when a 5 centimeter snowfall is announced. So we'll prepare a report and discuss it later on. I'd just like to clarify, if this is a notice of motion that you're intending to make, yes, that's right. And this will be considered at a regular meeting of Town Council of the 5th of December. Yes, at the regular meeting of Town Council of the 5th of December. This shall be debated then. Fine. Anything else? Let's go on now to question period. If there are any individuals that have questions of Town Council, now's the time for you to ask questions. Fine. The United Counties of Prescott and Russell. Well, I have a report with regard to ambulance calls. Many ambulances are called upon to answer calls from Ottawa. This call volume has increased by 105%. We're even answering calls stemming from the King Edward area, and we should not. We've sent a petition to the provincial government. We mentioned this to Premier Wynne a couple of weeks ago. They were compelled to pay us when we set foot with our vehicles on their territory, but they're not to, as of the implementation of this new act that has been, this new law that has been enacted in December. There, Renfrew and Stormont Dundas and Glengarry are also caught in the same quandary. There's a new press release. There's a press release that is freshly released with regard to this. Well, does Ottawa come and help us out when we need them? Very little. I'm sure they don't incur an increase of 105%. No, no. It wasn't as bad as that beforehand, but what happened was that they charged us back when they came down here. We charged them back when they went there, but since the old law has been abolished, they're called upon to pay us, and they don't want to pay us. That's why the bill is sent. Well, that's why the matter has been looked into by the province. Even the department has asked an investigation be conducted. Mr. Lalonde, well, at present, province pays 50% of the operational costs. Yes, that's true, but we're caught with the other 50%. Now, if we were to prepare a resolution and send it to the ministry, along with a copy to the Association of Municipalities of Ontario, so that it may be discussed at the next Association of Municipalities of Ontario's meeting and debated there, according to me, we might find a solution. These laws are enacted by individuals that live in big cities, in York, for example. Well, at present, a resolution has been drafted by the United Counties of Prescott Russell to that effect, has been sponsored by the warden of the United Counties of Prescott and Russell. Well, Mr. Mayor, I know that Ottawa comes here in Prescott Russell. Well, in 2015, our ambulances made 815 visits in the Ottawa area, as opposed to 110 visits by Ottawa to here. Up to September, we've answered 700 calls to Ottawa, non-reimbursable. Well, half of them are reimbursed, but the other half we have to pay for. But the United Counties resolution, is it calling for 100% reimbursement? No. Well, 50% of the part that we're not reimbursed for. See, it takes us much longer to obtain ambulances here in our area because of those ambulances that are caught up in Ottawa. They might come over with Montfort Hospital. They might answer a call in Montfort, the General Hospital in Ottawa, and remain there. Well, you'll recall, Mr. Mayor, in the month of February of last year, when we attended an Ottawa meeting, we had occasion to discuss things with Mr. DeRoos and another individual, two municipal councillors of the town of Ottawa, and they came up with a new resolution in Ottawa as of the 2017 budget that has been newly been adopted in Ottawa. They're going to start moving on this. Well, it's just for appearances sake that they're taking action. Well, it should alleviate, though, ambulance calls from us to them. Calls received from them by us. Well, there was a child that got hurt at a St. Pascal school, and it took 40 minutes, Mr. Mayor, for an ambulance to answer that call. You know, it was not a serious matter in this particular instance, but if it had been, it would have been another matter. Now, 750 calls have been answered as of the end of September. It costs us $300 and $350 per call that we pay out of our pocket. We're talking on the average $600 to $650 that the ministry pays out per call. At present, we get paid 50% from the ministry, and the other $300 ought to have been paid by the City of Ottawa, $350, and it has not. And we've answered over 750 calls as of the end of September. Well, that's a ridiculous situation, isn't it, Mr. Mayor? Yes. Let's go on now to the Services Committee report. Request to make use of the Optimist's Performance Hall free of charge. Do you want me to read it? Yes, well, that's fine then. Please read it. The Committee of the Whole recommend to Town Council that it approves an exemption of rental fees for the show called Ton Histoire est une épopée, organized by the Heritage Franco-Ontarian Orleans Committee and the Equid Epope, to be hosted by the Optimist Performance Hall in 2017, and that the Committee of the Whole recommend to Town Council that it accepts that the City of Clarence and Rockland become a community partner of this particular show in exchange for rental fees for this particular hall free of charge. Seconded by Councillor Lalonde. Any questions? All those in favor, carried then. Thank you. Let's go on to the next item. Fine then. All right then. Let's go. Sometimes we have to reboot our computers, Mr. Mayor, to have occasion to read those resolutions that we need to read during a particular meeting. Well, that's fine. I can continue reading. My computer's booted up. The Committee of the Whole recommend to Town Council that it adds $20,000 on an annual basis to its operational budget for the 2017 Community Services budget to shore up monies that are needed for the implementation of a country music festival, and that Mr. Saint-Cartier be granted a 2-year non-contingent contract to organize said country music festivity. Well, I believe that we ought not to be called upon to decide this matter at the end of 2 years or the next 3 years. The next elected council should be taking a decision. We're talking about 3 years of financing or support. Well, not 3 years worth of support. No. We're asking that a supplementary 3 years. Well, Mr. Mayor, it states here that there's a possibility of a 3 year prolongation of. Well, the reason that this resolution is drafted in such a manner is that in 2 years from now we'll have a new council sitting before us, and it will behoove this new council to accept this clause or not. Now, you're called upon to ratify the provisions for 2017, 2018 with regards to this project. The new council will be called upon to either accept or reject those provisions. Well, this means that we'll give $20,000 this year and $20,000 in 2018 for the implementation of a country music festival. Fine. Now, if the country music festival is a great success, has great success, and we make money, and we might have money in the bank to ensure a second music festival down the line. Well, it doesn't mean that the $20,000 will be given wholeheartedly to the organizers. The agreement will be looked into. The town council will look into the fine-tuning, if you wish, the agreement. All we wanted to do is to make sure that we set aside $20,000 to go ahead with the country music festival program or the event and its programming. Now, the maximum budget that you'll allow is before you now. So $20,000. $20,000 for a country music festival this coming summer. Mr. Boucher, I'd like to add the following, Mr. Mayor. The $20,000 is the maximum allowable amount as per the requirements of the budget that can be given for an event. That's right. Mr. Grimaud, that's right, Mr. Mayor. We'll set aside that amount of money, $20,000. It's not official that we'll spend $20,000. We've made an approximate tabulation as to what it would cost us. We've based ourselves on what it would cost us to host, what it cost us to host the Riverfront Festival. I looked at those events, and they've, of course, based themselves on the amounts involved in the organization of the Riverfront Festival. Well, I would certainly prefer to support this, prefer that this country music festival be held in the Rockland area, and people might make use of the camping facilities in our area. People like to walk at country music venues because those venues are close to where their campers are parked at. That's the only solution, really. I think that this might be an activity that might well fit into the 150th anniversary of Canada's foundation, and this could be considered as a 150th anniversary celebratory activity, if you wish. Well, fine. All those in favor? Carried then. Let's go on, shall we? Purchase of a snow of snowblower equipment. That the snow that we recommend the town council approve bylaw 2016-146 being a bylaw to authorize the mayor and the clerk to grant RG Incorporated for a detachable snowblower along with charger for a sum of $139,850, excluding GST. Seconded by? Well, I will second this particular motion, Mr. Mayor, along with my comments, if you wish, if you'll allow. I consulted the internet to determine what kind of equipment was up for sale, and definitely there was a snowblower this month that was up for sale. I consulted the internet last Friday. Involving a piece of equipment, it's not of the same brand as the one that we're purchasing now, but Councillor Grimaud had mentioned earlier on that there were some equipment up for sale, there were pieces of equipment up for sale in Western Canada. Well, you see, we're obtaining a $35,000 credit in light of the rental fees we were paying in the past. So, Councillor Grimaud, just to clarify, Councillor Lalonde, what I'd mentioned was that it might have been available, advisable to look down west to purchase a grader. Now, we'd like to be competitive with other individuals, but when we purchase this material, we're purchasing this equipment, if you wish, on an as-is basis. We don't know what shape it will be in when we receive it. I believe this equipment, of course, it will be purchasing, will be utilized at length. Well, in this particular instance, this blower will be pressed into service quite quickly, and will certainly be very useful when comes time to work with snow mixed up with ice. When the municipality purchases something, it competes with no one else. For example, you know, we purchased a fire truck that was used for many years. It was of a different color than red, and it lasted many years. We purchased another asset that for $8,000 that, with regards to its book value, was worth much more than $8,000. Fine. Let's go on to the presentation of the preliminary budget for the year 2017. And let's talk about the library. I see that she was making a beeline for the door. I thought that Mrs. Archambault was going to leave us early. All right, so we're dealing with the budget now, are we? Yes. Located right beside the YMCA, is it not? Oh, come on now. Come on, folks. All right now. All right, a small bit of confusion, but it's no problem that the library present their budget as they were waiting patiently. We were going to give you an overall city budget to put it in perspective, but it really doesn't matter if we go with the library then the corporate budget first. So we'll put the library budget up first. Do we have the presentation, or are we following along? No, Joanne is taking care of the presentation. Well, we're getting dirty looks from Mrs. Archambault. We have tab 6, public library, in our sheaf of documents, but I can't come up with tab 6 here on my computer screen. I can't find it. Got it. All right, we're good. I found it. Fine. Mr. Mayor? We've handed out some sheets. I just want to clarify that for council, because some of those are library sheets as well. So at the beginning, I mentioned that we were changing some of the sheets in your book. So just to go through the overview and summaries, page 15 was updated. In the overviews and summaries section, page 15 represents a summary for the whole town, including the library expenditures. Now that has been changed, modified. Now the old one is this one. Well, the good one is the one right up on top. Yeah. All right. So that's fine. That's fine. General government. The general government tab now, Mr. Mayor, page 1 and 2 were changed. This is called the live-in budget, the living budget. Now, the library tab, Mr. Mayor, library tab, pages 1 and 2 were changed, and I'll explain why they were changed. Just want to let you know. They were changed, but do we have the right one? Yes. You see, they were put in the binder for you. I see. Okay. They're very similar, and I'll explain the changes. Which page again? Which page? Well, under the library section, pages 1 and 2 were changed, were modified. And I'll explain everything that it was modified or changed. And last but not least, water, sewer, and waste, the summaries were modified because we didn't have the forecasts on hand when we drafted the first version. We do have the forecasts now with regards to the second version we've proposed to you. Mr. Mayor, these were just changes, basically. It didn't change anything in the budget. They were basically accounting changes, you know, the way we were reflecting the library board. it was technical, but we were showing it. Well, we were showing the text part was in a corporate summary as a contribution, and the library board was getting that taxed as a revenue. So we just eliminated that. What that did was that it increased the overall budget of the city revenue by 475 and the expense by 475. And so we removed that so that it shows the true impact. So it doesn't affect any of the library board figures. It just affects the corporate summaries. I just wanted to let you know that, Mr. Mayor. Is it my turn now? Yes. Well, hello? Hi. How do I work this, by the way? Oh, yeah. Plus forward and back. All right. Sorry about that. Yes. Right. My name. Oh, Katharina Rouse, CEO of the Clarence Rockland Public Library. I'm mostly going to speak in English here tonight because I'm better in English when I'm tackling figures and facts. If you do have questions in French, ask me your questions in French, no problems. Now, before I get into it, however, I want to say thank you to all of you. Since you guys came to sit at these desks, you've made a big impact on the library. We went through some pretty tough years, and since all of you support the library, we've seen some changes, and it's impressive. And it's all due to you guys. So, those changes? It's not changing. We're putting that in the budget to allow you to change slides. Oh, there we go. I'm sorry. There we go. This shows how drastic a change we've had in 2000. I've compared 2011 with our current projected 2016. We're already halfway through November, so we know approximately how much we're going to have for the whole of 2017. And I compared it as well with last year's figures to come up with a really true number. So we had 4,000, just a little over 4,000 cardholders in 2011. We are now past 7,000. 3,000 more cards. The actual visitors to the library, if you look at 2011, 58,000, has gone up now to 70,000. Visitors to the library, that's fantastic. This is spectacular. Programs, a lot of this actually is due to our programs. This is the future of libraries. Programming, events, activities such as story time, you know, things where kids can come and learn things. We also have things where adults can come and learn things, like about heritage gardening, for example. All of those things bring people in, and this is what people are looking for. And we have gone from 23 programs in 2011 with 279 people in attendance to 252 programs this past year with 5,400 people in attendance. That is what people are coming into libraries for now. And I think that you all remember a few years back that we couldn't buy any books. Do you remember that? We couldn't buy any books. Well, now we've bought books and our loans have doubled because we have what people are asking for. We used to have a suggestion binder by the front desk. It was two binders this thick full. It is now this. Because we have what people want. We have what they're asking for and they're taking it out. These are just some of our programs and events that we offer at the library. It's a big long list, which is why I've also printed it off for you. But I'll just point out a few of the items. We've got digital scrapbooking. This is a French program that is community-led. A group came to us and asked us if they could have it at the library, and we said, of course you can. Community-led programs are very important as well. We have book launches. Mr. Bouchamp launched his new book at the library, and we had Mr. Lalonde, who came to visit us for the book launch. Thank you very much. And we have, right now, we have Christmas cookie decorating in Bourget next week, requested by people in Bourget that attend the branch in Bourget. We had a card-making activity 2 weeks ago. They loved it. They said, let's do cookies. So we're doing that too. We're getting them even in the door in Bourget. So we're going to go for the cookies, of course. Yeah, of course, you're going to come for the cookies, but for the decoration purposes. Our most popular programs are Storytime. It's an ongoing program, the Storytime program, ongoing program throughout the year, and there are always kids going in and out of that, brothers and sisters growing up, and then when they come with their schools, we still see them and they say hi to us because they recognize us. We are, of course, and I think you all know about our summer reading club, the TD Summer Reading Club. It's very popular. We get kids reading, and they love it there. Now, something we've changed a bit this year. We've always been open having schools visiting us, but now we've actively entered into a relationship with Carrefour Jeunesse. They're having their library work done right now, as it's now part of a daycare, so it's being worked on. Now, they're not sure if they're actually going to have the library built into this new section, so they've asked us to provide library services for them. So we've entered into an agreement with them. They have 3 or 4 visits per week where they have classes actually come to the library. And we're going to be doing debates, and we're going to have projects involving a bunch of books. We're going to go back and forth. Mr. Lortzi, the principal of the school, are going to do a back and forth with the books, and in this way they won't miss anything while their library is under construction. We've also gotten a lot more from from the two high schools, the French and the English. L'Escale and Rockland District High have both been coming in droves. We've been holding workshops with their help, and with them we've had Carrefour Jeunesse, Rockland Public School, and Saint Trinity. They take little walks and they come to the library. So we have, on average, about, give or take, 10 or 15 class visits a week now. So they're enjoying it. They're enjoying the services. We always do. Well, it depends on the grade. We make it in accordance with their needs. With high school, we show them how to do research, how to make use of our online resources to find credible resources, and that seems to be going rather well. As you can see, it's a community center, and this is what happens. This is what's happening. Oh, I'm sorry, it's still going. There we go. This is what's happening across Ontario. Due to those programs and events that the libraries are hosting, people are coming into the library more now. So it's a misconception that libraries are going down in Ontario. They're actually going up. People are attending libraries more than they ever did, because community needs are being met through these programs and services. So I got this off the Federation of Ontario's Public Libraries website. Every year they take figures from all of the libraries across Ontario, 72.5 million visits per year. In 2013, that number was 198,000. That's just Ontario. That's not Canada. That's just Ontario. That's how many people visited libraries in Ontario. That is spectacular. That's not going down. That's not going away. As you all know, libraries are part of an education, and it's part of the community, and you've invested in it very well, by the way. And your citizens are recognizing that, and they're coming. Oh, I like that slide, by the way. Look at this. 12 million more visits in Ontario alone than the whole of the NHL, NBA, and NFL put together across North America. Public libraries, 72.5 million in Ontario. And that's all for North America, by the way. Those other figures. So it's not just sports anymore. The library still counts as something in this world. Now, out of cultural activities, public libraries, percentage of Canadians attending, 73%. So ready to crunch some numbers? Let's crunch some numbers then. This is what you received originally. Myself and Sylvie Archambault, who's the president of the library board, who spoke with Helen earlier last week. I went back and tore this apart, by the way. You were talking about 17.5%? No, I tore it apart. I flung stuff out and did the best I could. Let's forget that 17.5%. Mr. Kehoe, was there with an eraser? No, I didn't even need an eraser, by the way. I just needed to think about where things were coming from and where they would go to, and where it could be, things could be better served. Needs could be better met. 2015, 16, and 17 now. We've gone up. 566 and 44 we're asking for. What does that mean? It doesn't really tell you anything. Well, we've brought it down to 91,000. All right, all we have left here, all of this represents is our contractual obligations and changes to the consumer price index, which is 1.256% and not a 1/2015. This request actually puts us below the consumer price index. This request. Hydro, everybody knows. We can't seem to stay ahead of hydro. I don't know what's going on with hydro, but we've been going into every year, you know, for hydro. We're trying to correct that here. The salaries, I will address that in the next slide. The increased operational costs, that's just normal cost of living increases. Some of the programs that we deal with on a regular basis are with regards to integrated library services, they've gone up in price. All of these things are mandatory. We have no choice. We're locked in. And we have a change in revenue from the school board. And that has cost us more or less? Less. 18,000. Why? Well, this was actually an error on our part. Last year, we'd budgeted for 100,000. It should have been not have been $100,000. It should have actually have it ought to have been $80,000. So I had to make an adjustment this year. We're not receiving in 2016 $100,000 from the school board. So I had to adjust figures to $90,000. Salaries, $38,000. It's collective agreement obligations plus. But this plus represents the collective agreement obligations we just finalized this past week. This does not represent just 2017. This represents a big portion of 2016 as well, because we did not have a number in place last year because our collective agreement ended November 1st or November 31st. I'm sorry. Pardon? 2015. And we did not have that figure until this week. So that figure represents 2016-2017, and it also represents two employees that had only been budgeted for, and they were approved for 2 years. They were only budgeted for half of a salary for half of the year. This is the other half of the year, and the previously approved part-time employee changed to full-time. That's the half portion that was the webmaster that was approved in 2015. So these are already in place. These are contractual obligations. I must say that there's no frill in here. If we have any cuts in this, it's going to be to our service. Unfortunately, this is what we're left with. How do we compare it? How do we compare it to other libraries? Well, I think that you've seen this every year for the past few years. Right now, if we look at the average, we're in green there. We're at $18 per capita. Now, if we look at the average, this is the average. I put in Plantagenet, Belleville, but then I tried to put in some that were our size, like Orangeville, 28,000, Prince Edward County, 25,000. I'm trying to keep it in our size, and the actual municipal grant per capita average is $42. So I know that last year there'd been talk about trying to raise that as well. So we're not quite there yet, but we've definitely improved from this $18, which is excellent. And what this budget change would mean, $23 per capita. So we're going in the right direction, which is up. But this budget represents keeping the services as they are. We hope to add a few more this year. This year we've got on plan to add some adult services. And we also have entered into a community agreement to start lending out sports equipment in Bourgette, which we hope will be quite popular. And so we don't want to cut services. We don't want to cut these programs that are actually bringing people through the door. This is our community. This is what our people, you know, come to use. They come to use our library as a community hub, if you wish. Now, I believe it is part of the grand scheming of our community centers and our arenas. We're all in it together. We're in the YMCA building. We're trying to actually connect with the Y more on Family Day. We are actually normally closed, but we're going to be opening in 2017. We have three employees that are volunteering to work on that day so that all of the people who are going to enjoy Mr. Mayor's swim time can also come down to the library afterwards, or while they wait for their turn to come up, they can also go to the library. So we want to be there and accessible for the citizens. So thank you for protecting your investment, because the library is definitely that. It's an investment that the city has made and continues to make, and I do appreciate your consideration. Thank you very much. Question, Mr. Zanta? Well, first of all, thank you for your presentation. You had said at the beginning that you thanked us for the money. But I'd like to thank you and members of your team for taking the funds and turning them into something that's clearly working. Thank you. And I just wanted to remind everybody at Town Council table that there are not too many things that we can do in this city, and the library is pretty much the only thing that we have aside from that and the YMCA. There are no arcades, no bowling alleys, no movie theaters. I think it's a huge investment, and like you said, what you're asking for is literally bare bones. So that's all I had to say. Thank you to you and members of your team, then. Well, thank you for your presentation. I had two questions. Now, hydro costs. I'm taking a look at hydro costs. $12,200 over and above. Last year, you had budgeted $28,700 worth of hydro. This means that hydro is going to cost us $41,000. It's a major difference. You might ask Robert. Robert, $40,000 sounds about right? Yeah, sounds about right. Yes. We've been paying over and above $40,000 for the past 2 years. We've talked last year about finding a solution, you know, partnering with YMCA. You see, the YMCA is not splitting there. Somebody is paying for someone else. I know. We should have a meter just for library use in the past. We discussed about this. I don't know if it's possible. Well, that was before May. I'm not sure. You see, Mr. Tivierge was an electrician. He was a member of town council. He knew pretty much about what was going on. He checked that out. There was a problem. Well, don't they divide this up by square footage? Yes. So how on earth is the library paying almost more? We're paying more. The YMCA has more square coverage than the library has. You know, they have the pool, the exercise area, the gym. Well, you know, it's a big jump from $28,000 to $40,000. It certainly took us by surprise, let me tell you. Well, yes. Libraries are paying 20% of the total bill, so $40,000 is 20% of the bill that goes towards hydro. They have a building that measures 10,000 square feet, comes up to $4 per square feet per year for hydro, which is pretty... Well, what's on the market right now? I'm not saying, and Mr. Mayor, you're right, when you said that there was no other way to define the problem other than what we're defining it as at present. You know, we might call in a firm that might assess everything that's involved. We cannot put in an extra meter just to find out what going on, because the way in which hydro is spread through the building, you know, we cannot isolate the library from the rest of the building to do that part. We would need to hire an electrical engineer that would study every fixture in the area and tell us how much hydro they would consume on an average day, for example, in order to determine the exact amount of usage there is at the library. Councillor Zant, two things, Mr. Mayor. Actually, I take my comments back with regards to square footage, because the pool is heated. Even though they're on a square footage basis, they use way more hydro than what they're blindly assessed as. Well, they pay 80% of the bill. Second thing, though, we made a deal with the school whereby they could use the facilities, right? So the gym, the weights, the pool, the library. Shouldn't the school be paying a certain portion of that hydro bill? They are, and it's still $40,000? Yes. The only thing is that their rental rate goes up as per the consumer price index based on last year's expenditures. Well, when we prepared our budget, we had section A, B, and C in our document, and A is really non-discretionary contractual. These are the type of items that are covered in our Part A. And if we argued that the library board doesn't pay this, it's going to be the YMCA, and we're going to be in discussions with them, and they're going to want, oh, you know, somebody's got to pay. Quite frankly, it's a bill for the library board. It's a pressure on them. I would suggest, as a minimum, that they add it to their budget, Mr. Mayor. That's what I suggest. Councillor Lalonde, do you have anything else to add? Well, Councillor Simoneau is quite right in saying that in 2015, we predicted that hydro would cost $44,000 because we'd budgeted too low a figure to come up with $28,700. We thought we'd made a mistake then. We wished, we wanted hydro costs to be looked into, but apparently it was not a mistake. Salaries represent, well there's an increase of 52,000. In 2015 we had 334, now we have 473 along with a part-time. I don't know if she has that particular document. I don't understand, Mr. Lennon, what you're getting at. The salaries this year, there's an increase of $52,000. Yes, that's going to leave us with a $473,000 expenditure because, yes, that's right, as opposed to last year's expenditures. Yes, last year, in 2016 and 2015, you had $179,400 budgeted for full-time staff and $155,000 for part-time staff, amounting to $344,000 in previous years. So this year's figures represent an increase of $140,000 worth of salaries in the past 2 years. Yes, yes, but as of 2012 and 2013, we had 8 employees, now we have 15. You have how many employees? 15. To offer services that are needed, we need all of this staff. All of these staff positions were approved during the budgetary process. They were all approved because of the increase in demand. Councillor Simoneau? Go ahead, Mr. Lalonde. The school board's annual contribution to all of this, does it increase? Is it decrease? Does it remain stable? It remains stable. Last year, of course, I did not take part in the preparation of the budget per se. I was off on sick leave, so I didn't have the necessary info. The people that were preparing the budget on my behalf were not cognizant of the details. Do we know the amounts that the school board is... Obviously, we keep saying that there's more and more traffic. That means that there are more and more students going in. So, therefore, more money from the school board should be coming in. Well, you see, the amount that was put in last year was wrong. This is what she's saying. In 2015, we had 88,000. But my question is this. The yearly amount from the school board, does it remain the same? Yes. Well, it's based on contract. Or does it go up at least slightly every year? Yes. It's going up in keeping with the consumer price index based in the on the Ottawa-Gatineau region with regards to last year's figures. Now, do we know if that amount that they give us is proportionate to other cities? If you compare us to other cities, for example, libraries, for example, in other cities, is that amount proportionate? Or are we being underfunded by the school board? That has not been reviewed. The contract, I think, is soon up for review. I'm not sure if that's going to be... I know that Pierre Boucher and myself have to attend the school board to deal with. As mentioned, given the hydro hikes, that could also be taken into account. Normally, with property management, lease amounts do go up when hydro and electricity go and all that goes up, so... might be worth contacting the Castleman High School because they're working on a similar operational basis and determine what type of amount they receive from this particular school board. Well, that's a bit different because Castleman is located within the school-based library. It's not the library that rents space from the school. The library is located within the school proper. I see. But what I'm wondering is this. Is the amount that's given to us based on a fair assessment? Mr. Boucher might answer this. Well, let me answer this, I'm the one that has the figures before myself. We're making the request for what the town needs, including the wise share. Now, from a school board standpoint, they set a per diem, per student figure with regard to the use of part of it goes to the laboratory, another laboratory use, another part goes for library use. I have a spreadsheet that deals with the methods that are made use of to come up with those figures, and I can give you further explanations tomorrow at a forthcoming meeting. Well, does the school board give out the proper amount? Is this a standardized amount? That's what we're seeking to determine. Well, I didn't come up with any comparables with other school boards because probably from one town council to another, agreements might be different. They might not be built along the same lines, if you wish. Given the original agreement we entered into with the school board, let's not forget that the cultural and recreational, as well as the library complexes, are built on property owned by the school board. We own the building, but the school board owns the property on which the building rests. So, given the original agreement, we are working with the tools that had been implemented at that time, at the time of the implementation, if you wish, of the operational agreement involving town council and the school board, as well as the library authorities at that time. What I can do tomorrow is to come up with the manner in which those funds are distributed. Yes, I understand. But if Castleman belongs to the school, this library belongs to the school, the school might have its own library. The school had its own library, but there was an agreement that was entered into in between the town and the school board. You're right. That was an agreement that was arrived at involving the school board, the municipality, and the library board. The government is seeking our multiple partnerships. That's why we received thousands of dollars from the federal and provincial governments, because we entered into an agreement with different partners. Well, I'm just wondering again whether we're paying out a proper amount, or is it higher or lower than the mean average across Ontario? If those people making use of the public library resources, if they pay much less, if we're underfunded with regards to our school board, where do we situate ourselves in with regard to the mean average shared throughout the province? Councillor Simoneau, well, if we take a look at the Castleman situation, if we take a look at the per capita share, they pay $60 as compared to $18 per citizen. Yes, but they have 9,000 citizens. Well, 3,184 people down there in Castleman, given the requests made by them, will still wind up at $23 per capita. We're still going to be the lowest of all those set out in the list that was supplied to us. I believe that investing in education, I figure that investing in a library reaps much more profit than investing $100,000 in gravel, if you wish. Councillor Levert, it might be interesting to determine whether if the Castleman School is the same size as the Lescal School, it might impact the operational budget with regard to their own library. It could give us an idea. Well, the population is a bit different. They're dealing with a different type of population here. Mr. Kehoe, it's always difficult, Mr. Mayor, to take a look at comparables from stemming from another municipality, because there are variables that are quite different from one town to another. There are many variations that come into play. So it's difficult to come up with a blanket solution. Castleman has 3,184 citizens, ratepayers. But we're past that. We're way past that. We're not in the same league, right? We have to look at cities that are in our league. Yeah, but we're not questioning your budget, ma'am. We're just questioning the amount that the school board is giving us. Yes, but it still impacts the difference depending on the size of the school that's involved, you see. Well, I'm just playing devil's advocate. I know I'm going to be attacked right and left, but let me tell you. Let me ask this. You see, the population being smaller has to pay a bit more to have the same amount of services that we have. Go ahead, Councillor Simoneau. I know you're going to say something vis-à-vis my remark. I'm going to ask this particular question. If we learn that school board's contribution, let's say we receive 88% less than others, what are we going to do with the budget if we receive 8%? What's that going to, what kind of impact is that going to cause to our budget tonight? Let me ask you this. It's not going to impact anything. Well, it doesn't impact in any way, shape, or form anything, but we can go to the school board and say, well, listen, you know, we're underfunded by you good folks by about 8%. Well, let's not slow down the implementation of the budget process because of this. No, I agree with that. I think we're all in agreement to support our library, but if the school board supplies its fair share, we, instead of being at 23, we might be at 30. It doesn't change anything. All right. Any other questions then? Yes, may I snowball it and put it all in one big lump then? You see, this year, we're going based on what we've done this year. I'm not asking for extra. I'm not asking for fluff, or I'm not asking to be able to go getting involved in extra activities that were not already planned. I'm just asking to continue what we've got now, to maintain what we have now. That's all I'm asking. Do you have to put two employees? I know they were talking about putting in two employees in our rural areas because of safety concerns. Well, in keeping with our collective agreement, we need to have two people at the same time, all the time in the building, like in Bourget. How about in Hammond and Clarence Creek? Well, those are there in attendance when there is school, 2 hours a week for each location. Of those three, yes. Any other questions? Do we vote on each budget? Or do we vote? Well, how do we do it? How do we go about doing this? Well, we're just keeping track of what's going on. So in summary, what Mrs. Russ has presented to you tonight, so instead of the $111,000, to revise that number down to $91,000, identifying the very specific base budget requirements that she has due to collective agreement requirements, the error of the budget for the statement of revenue, and hydro. So the $91,000, just so it's clear, and I know that, you see, that $91,000 is not included in the 3.26% that we're going to present to you in a minute. That's the increase, 3.26% increase. So you could ask us to add the $91,000, and we could look at other ways to offset that as we move through the budget tonight, tomorrow, and Wednesday. All right, then. All right. So we add $91,000. So we should pass a motion to include the $91,000 that's been requested by the Library Board. And then as we go through the budget for the rest of tonight, tomorrow, and Wednesday, we can look at offsetting changes. But it's a preliminary approval. Moved by Councillor Zant and seconded by Councillor Simoneau. All those in favor? Carried then. Well, thank you. Thank you. So should we let Mr. Keogh talk now? No, not yet. He's going to be last up. That's how he likes it. All right, then. Let's go on now with the presentation of the 2017 draft budget. Mr. Mayor, just before Helen starts, just to clarify with Katrina, so that the increase of $91,000, you see there's already $9,472 included in the base budget for 2017, so it's $91,000 less $9,472. Every 10,000 that we make, Mr. Mayor, is 10,000. All right, well, thank you. Fine. All right, Mrs. Collier, the floor is yours. Well, thank you, Mr. Mayor. Thank you. So, thank you for listening to the library board first, because they've been waiting for a little while this evening. Myself and our Director of Finance and Economic Development will be presenting to you the overall 2017 draft budget, and that will include both the operating and the capital budget. I have to thank all of the directors, the managers, and staff that support us in our day-to-day work that allowed us to pull off this budget here tonight. We've been feverishly working toward the November deadline. We are almost a month ahead of where we were last year, but it will give us a budget approval in early December. I just want to make sure that we move forward a little bit, and it'll become easier as we move forward. So a big thank you to our staff. Tonight, we're going to present to you a budget that introduces some challenges that we're having within the base budget. Now, these challenges are very real, and we want to present them for your consideration this evening. And these challenges either need to be dealt with this year or next year. So I'm going to walk you through some of the highlights that are in the budget. We're going to walk you through the impact on the tax rate. We're going to look at the staffing distribution. We're going to look at what the detailed budget pressures are, and we're also going to show you a picture of where the tax dollars go. And then we're going to show you then how much an average person in Clarence and Rockland contributes to each of the activities. And then we're going to show you in absolute dollars, total expenditure in the city, how that money gets spent. And against that, we will then be showing you the actual revenue that comes in to the city to help pay for all of the expenditures. And then I'm going to take a few minutes and talk to you a little bit about asset management. That's one of my major priorities for the city and our staff to work on in the upcoming year, to get our asset management plan in front of you and get everyone comfortable with the plan and the work that needs to be done. We're going to look at the capital financing that's required to deliver the capital program that's before you this evening. And then we're going to look at the rate impact on water, sewer, and waste, and a quick look at the timetable. Of course, at the end, there'll be an opportunity for questions. So this evening, one of the key highlights in the budget presented to you this evening is that there are no fee increases for transit, recreation, no fee increases for transit, recreation, and the majority of city fees and charges. Part of the reason for this is that in previous years, in 2016, we increased the fees, and we've just about made the revenues this year, so we don't want to inflate the fees and not achieve those revenues. Now, when you inflate a revenue in the budget and you don't achieve it, it's very difficult to amend that revenue. If you put an expenditure in a budget, you have a choice to stop spending, and then it doesn't cause you any pressure at the end to create a deficit. So we prefer not to increase fees this year. Ongoing daycare and transit deficits are addressed in this budget. As each of these departments will present their budget, they'll explain how that's addressed. And there are no increases in the city's debt servicing for this year. So the additional debt will be taking on the impact of the budget. Now, your car payment that you're used to, for example, that payment is not going to change into 2017. Water and sewer rates are at 2% and 3.5% respectively, and this is what was presented to you in the previous year's budget. Infrastructure projects are paid off using a surplus from a debt servicing cost. So in 2016, because our debt got issued late in the year, we didn't have to make a debt payment in 2016, which freed up some money. So we kind of saved the car payment in 2016, and we were able to pay down. We're recommending to you that you pay down the debt which you got in the report earlier this evening, which meant that we had to issue less debt. We have a fairly significant investment infrastructure this year, $15.2 million, and we'll be running through the details of that as we go through each budget with you. Before we get into the details in the book, I have to inform you of a few post-budget book adjustments. The budget book, as Rob had mentioned earlier tonight, is a living document. So there were a few items that were amended after the book was published. Now, the first item was the Western Festival. You'd asked staff in a motion last council meeting to find an offsetting savings to fund the $20,000. So there are two adjustments in public works. The science budget, there were funds there that we felt we could reduce that had not been spent for the last 2 years. So we found $10,000. And the grass cutting budget, it should have been amended down because there's a proposal to purchase additional mowing equipment, which will reduce the amount of contracts that we'll hand out. So this funds the $20,000 required for the Western Festival. Now, the CIP program had been omitted from the budget. A number of $100,000 had been floated around at about the size of the program, and that's $50,000 coming from the municipality and $50,000 from the commercial entity. The snowbank removal on Laurier Street had been omitted from the draft budget book, so we've identified it here. Forêt La Rose, well, you see, there's a revenue loss here because we're no longer providing the service to Forêt La Rose, and that represents a net gain of $20,000. We may reintroduce that item in future years, but right now, the way it stands, we would see that as a loss and a pressure on our deficit for 2017 if we did not remove it from the budget. Was staff not being paid with that money? It was actually a net gain. It was not net zero. All right, now in building services, so this is a construction budget. We went back and revised the actual construction projection for next year. You will see in the original, well, in Mr. Keogh's report to you, there was a revenue loss of $114,000. Well, we no longer have to take that loss because we've identified enough development happening next year. We don't have to reduce our budget. So that's a good thing that we take off the pressure list. And then there was a one-time adjustment that was noticed that our accountant can explain to you. These were items basically that were identified outside, well, after the budget was put together. So it's a net of minus $10,000, and that's a good, well, and that's good. It's all to the good to help the bottom line here. Yes, ma'am? Just coming back to La Rose Forest this time around. Did the counties decide that we did not want to No. As you know, we had severe staffing shortages in bylaw this year. We were unable to provide that service to them. Our service level demands with the 5 bylaw officers that we have now are significant enough. Nation was willing to take on the responsibility for a year. So while we rebuild the bylaw services, it seemed like a good opportunity to allow that to happen. There's a significant amount of training that has to happen to provide the service in Forêt La Rose, and we only had one, maybe two officers that were trained to do that. The snowbank removal on Laurier Street. We're talking about $20,000 here. Yes? Where does the $20,000 come from for the snowbank removal on Laurier Street? Well, when the council approved this policy, there was no funding identified. There was just a request to put it into the budget for 2017. You think that $20,000? You think that it will be sufficient? It seems that, look. This is just to remove the snowbanks in extreme situations. So, do you have the numbers, Mr. Darch? Yes. We did some of that anyway, did we not? You see, if you feel okay with this $20,000 amount, I remember the report that we had. It mentioned about $5,000 per event. We had a pipe that was broken in the past. So, if I re remember the report correctly, it's sort of extra expenditures we'd incurred. Well, there was an increase in service, though. The 20,000, I just happened to have discussions today with our manager on this one, and there was a report. I think there were five events that we were budgeting for. We had gone to tender on this and had actually come in higher, but we feel that there is some room for negotiation there. We can probably, well, it's going to be in between $20,000 to $25,000 in that range. So 20 is as good as anything right now, but it's to reflect the service level change that council approved when it adopted the new snow removal policy. Well, when you say savings on grass cutting, saying that, well, we're going to have less contract work and we're going to purchase a mower. Correct, yes. I presume that the $20,000 will be just a savings of sorts. It's actually $10,000. So if we had less contract work, but we purchase, let's say, a $32,000 mower, for example, and we hire an employee to ride it, to operate it, well, we're not hiring an employee. That's just as an example. You see, we've had recent discussions on this one. I think, given the original draft, we'd contemplated $16,000 for grass cutting, but with the acquisition, if council approves the mower budget that's in the capital component, we feel that we can take it down to $5,000. Now, that item. So it's about $10,000 or $11,000 leeway. So, grass cutting, that's with regards to the roads. That's not in the parks or anything else. That's right, that's right. Well, thank you. Ah, we're getting somewhere now. That's fine. Now the savings. So it's always nice to, well, you see, cutting grass along the road. Did we not buy a tractor last year for that particular purpose, to cut all the grass along the ditches? No, we contracted that out. We were leasing out a piece of equipment for that purpose, I believe. Now, just to cycle back on the signs this time around, we have a base budget of $38,000. We've been spending the last 2 years $23,000, so we feel secure in taking $10,000 and still leave a base of $28,000 to work on the reflective program. All right then. Okay, it's your turn now. Mr. Kehoe is going to take you through the complicated numbers, and I'm going to come back and talk to you about a little bit about asset management. Very good then. I hope you all noticed that he got all dressed up tonight. It's rather unusual. Well, these are not new issues, Mr. Mayor, and does not reflect any spending increases with regards to the budget that's contemplated. The first thing, Helen gives the presentation over to me. The first thing that I have to notice is that there's a typo. So the first number, 574064, is 584064, as you've seen in the previous slide, and I did double check it while Ellen was talking. It is. So the way in which we broke up the pressures, Mr. Mayor, is that we identified them by non-discretionary. Non-discretionary is really trying to get at contractual, things that are very difficult for council to say no to. So we have a contract in place. So collective agreements is a good example of this. There are very strong costs involved, if you will. Yeah, okay, let's go on now. So, those give us an increase of 3.21%. That does not take into account the previous table. If we, or does it? Yes, we updated the slide. Oh, yes, we did. So, in your report, it's 3.26, but we've reflected it to 3.21. That takes into account the net 10,000 that Mrs. Collier just showed you. Public library was over and above. We just went through public library. So what we've done is that they had a pressure of $111,000. We've netted that down to around $80,000. That will be reflective as we perform changes on this table. So the 0.62 impact will be lower than that. We'll get back with the figures. It's a lower amount there. Service level increase. Class C, it's not that they're not important cost pressures by any stretch of the imagination, but basically the director is showing you areas. You know, you're asking us to get these things done, and in order to get things done, there are pressures, and each of the directors are going to describe to you what those are. So in total, Mr. Mayor, of all the pressures identified, that the council was willing to go ahead with them, it's $1,248,000, or a tax rate increase for 2017 of 6.92%. Now, the bottom line is capital budget. As Mrs. Collier had mentioned earlier, $15.2 million is what we have proposed for the capital budget for 2017. We'll be going through those details in the next few days. We'll have to go through... Oh, I have to click this thing. That's right. There we go. So we're going to go through the details of your eight items. So, Mr. Mayor, the non-discretionary items on the good side, on the revenue side, assessment-based increase. So again, the new properties, commercial and residential in Cranlands and Rockland 2017, have brought in an additional $240,000 of assessment that we're able to use for the 2017 budget. And that has been confirmed. And that's a good number every year. You know, we're not sure if we've got the final figure, and that is the final figure. Elimination, if you'll recall, last year, Mr. Mayor, we were talking about the daycare budget. We made a one-time contribution from our reserve to daycare. That is now in pressure this year of $126,000. Ontario Municipal Partnership Fund, although this shows up as a pressure, Mr. Mayor, this is a good news story. The last four budgets at Clarence and Rockland, maybe more, there has been a reduction of up to $100,000 each year from the Ontario government. In their conditional grant that they provide to us, this was the last. You see, 2016 was the last year. The province announced that in 2017, it's frozen. Now, this is just another pressure is a reflection of the fact that we did not have the proper amount last year. At the time, we were out by about $7,900, so we're just making that correction. OCIF grants, the net number, it's an in and an out, Mr. Mayor, but that number is wrong. It's double than that. It's $230,000. But there's another offsetting contribution to capital, so it doesn't affect our net tax situation. I just want to add that $115,000 is actually the increase that the province is giving us in our funding this year. So last year we received $115,000. That's why we showed 115. Yeah, we could look at it that way. Yes, you're correct. So instead of having 115 dedicated funding to infrastructure, it's gone up to 230,000. That's why we only showed $115,000 increase. So it's a 100% increase in funding on that item. Mr. Mayor, provincial offenses, you'll recall last year, we had a particular year. There was a lot of pressure on our budget. We had the OPP come and speak to council, or I think at the county level, and I believe they came. I don't know where they spoke, but anyways, they spoke to somebody in here as well. We're taking this down a little bit now, Mr. Mayor, hoping that in 2016 it's showing better than in 2015. Again, we're being prudent to take that budget down just a little bit. So there's a bit of risk in that number. Salary increments and cost of living, Mr. Mayor, is $200,000. As you know, the union contract has been approved. Non-union is still subject to approval. We've made provisions in there for that. One of the things, Mr. Mayor, I'd like to talk to Library Board tomorrow, well, not the Library Board, but the Chair, is that she had some numbers on salary, and I really want to talk to her about that particular number. I'd like to try to get that $81,000 down, but I'll speak to her tomorrow, because we do have provisions in our budget for library board increases. The next item, Mr. Mayor, benefit increases, 26.8%. So we heard from our benefits provider, And we have basically a consortium that does it on behalf of the counties. There are four of the municipalities that are part of this consortium. And our experience rating has went up considerably. Our rates went up 26% in 2016 and 2017. Is it because we have too many claims? Yes, we have too many claims in different areas. They do the insurance stuff, and it's almost as complicated as complicated as accounting, let's put it this way. Now, negotiated benefit increases, Mr. Mayor. During your collective bargaining this year, you negotiated some increases that reflect the cost, pay as you go. We've discussed this over the last 3 years. I've talked about this in my guideline report to you in June. We have to start putting more money in terms of current year's tax dollars to pay down and pay out of cash capital projects to limit the amount that we will borrow in the future. And this is really council starting to take a little bit of pain to save future taxpayers and future councils from rising debts. There's nothing wrong with debt, but you need a manageable debt versus pay-as-you-go programs. So this involves an increase. It should be much higher than that, but this is considerably low. But giving the pressures on the budget, we're representing that amount. On the IT side, that's one of my areas, over $51,000. You'll see here there are other pressures of $141,000 in IT. Some of it is that we've taken IT and we've centralized it. And what it is this. We've taken costs that previously were incurred by another department and now focusing it all on IT. But also it has to do with the big investment that we made this year, $500,000 to upgrade our IT systems. There are real costs that come with that. So $51,000, I'm thinking that's low. But I'm asking council for that budget increase, and through 2017 and through our status reports when we'll come to you, I'll be speaking to you about whether or not we'll be able to meet the IT budget. So we really need that increase. And there's the other offset, OCIFs. It goes in as revenue, goes out as capital. So we're just showing you an in and out. There's no net effect on the OCIF grant here. Now, Mr. Mayor, I mentioned before, I think the OPP billing model for 2017 has a net impact to us of $60,000. $60,000 is $60,000, but there are other municipalities that have had a much greater impact. At the end of the day, it's a good news story for Clarence and Rockland. Budget-based stabilization, Mr. Mayor. Budget-based stabilization. There's $148,000 in CRT. That's budget pressure. That's taking up half of this. Half of this is to deal with all the other pressures that are identified in Schedule C. Schedule C, which we discussed earlier, there's some $500,000 of pressures. Now, we don't expect council to raise tax rates 6.97%, but we're identifying real pressures. And we feel strongly that if council sees fit to improve this, that we'll be applying these to the right areas at the right pressure areas. So we'll discuss that as we go through the budget, Mr. Mayor. Corporate services has a net reduction of $14,949. You'll see that in the corporate services budget coming up. Debt servicing costs, budget doesn't increase, but the costs do, however, increase. And I'll talk about that a bit in a future slide. So our total pressures are $1,000,029, tax rated impact of 5.75%. Then, sorry, Mr. Mayor, there we are. I got lost just a little bit here, just a tad bit. We went through that, the library, fine. Now, our level C. All right, Mr. Mayor, with regards to level C, what happened to slides 11 and 12, Mr. Keogh? I believe you skipped over those. I apologize, I went the wrong way with my pointer. Those are discretionary revenues, Thank you, Mr. Mayor. I'm glad to see that you're feeling better. All right. Programs. These are important. They're called discretionary revenues because these are really things that council can say yes or no to. Program support to rate services. We did that last year, Mr. Mayor. We were charging some of our overheads over to water and sewer. And that's because the services that are on the tax supported side, all the staff are there, and we provided services on the water and sewer side of the business. So it's simply a transfer of tax room over to water and sewer. We did that last year. I recommend we do it again this year, and I think we're at a good level because we're lower in comparison to other municipalities as to how much of our cost we transfer to water and sewer. Recovery staff costs from capital. Now, this is a solution that we're suggesting, Mr. Mayor, to help us with our pressures on the operating side. You see, we have three staff that work entirely on capital projects. So we are suggesting that 30% of their salaries be recovered against capital projects. Again, that provides relief to our tax rate, but it puts pressure on each of those capital projects. By the way, Mr. Mayor, I spoke about this when we were finalizing the 2015 audit with our new auditors, and they were very comfortable with that approach. They would have no issue with that, with us doing that. It's like a left hand giving to the right hand. Yes, but it's providing you tax rate relief, Mr. Mayor, in the current year. But yes, it's going to put pressure on your capital budget. It's going to be taking money from your reserves, a bit from the pay-as-you-go also. So yes, it is kind of speaking. It's providing you with tax relief this year, Mr. Mayor. Tax account changes. Now, last year we approved fee increases on the non-water, sewer, and daycare side of about $165,000, as Helen was mentioning earlier. Now, this year we're not recommending changes to that because in some instances we were not able to meet the targets. Maybe we put them too high, so we're going to relax on them. One area, however, was tax account changes, and we saw an increase of revenues there. So I'm increasing the revenue budget on tax account changes. Our investment income is doing well also, and it should do better once we get our $12 million in the bank that we just signed off on today in terms of the long-term borrowing. So that's going to help our bank account. We're going to be making more money next year. I might even be able to increase that a bit more. I won't say it too loud or Helen will hear me. This being said, Mr. Mayor, the public library, as mentioned earlier, there's an error in our accounting for them. It is unfortunately a pressure of $34,000. Program support, 3% increase. That's just our overheads. We are recovering another $12,000 against the rate-supported services over and above the $100,000 above. Telephone savings, Danny Petrello did a lot of work in terms of shutting down some of our phone lines that were no longer being used, so we're looking at saving at least $20,000. We're passing that on in this budget, Mr. Mayor. I don't even know where I'm at anymore. Okay. Net effect of proposed fee changes. Oh, yes. Mr. Mayor, these next two items deal with daycare. Now, daycare have increased their fees to meet the one-time $126 from last year, and they've done it over and above the $126 by $60,000. That's in order to get to a balanced budget for daycare. And Mr. Boucher will discuss that on Wednesday, further on Wednesday. So that is the net pressure, 3.6% for eight items, those discretionary items, and then we have the Public Library Board that we talked about earlier. And finally, and I call them service level increases, but there's no description for all of these. There are all important budget pressures. There are three new positions in this budget identified in the C-level type increases. One is in the IT area without a word of a lie, Mr. Mayor, the manager of IT, Mr. Mayor, has been putting in hours beyond. It's just a little silly, and he's working very hard, a little too hard. It's a shop that are at 2, and they need to be at 3. So we're going to have to do something to get them at 3. I don't know what we're going to do, but it just can't survive on 2 people. There are 80 hours being worked on in a week. And those are okay once in a while, but not on a sustained basis. The other item is for a very important engineering inspector. And Dave will speak more about that tomorrow night. I mentioned earlier, Mr. Mayor, in the A pressures, that there was $51,000 for IT, but there's another $141,000 that we're going to have to build in eventually. These are real costs, real licenses, if you wish. These are not imaginary items. We can't bring them all in under the 2016 budget. It's just too much. But you have to be aware that there are some real pressures. Mr. Petrello has provided me a three-page list of these things. They're very techie-oriented. If you want to hear about those, I'll be happy to talk about them on Wednesday. I won't bring them up right now. Protective Services has some pressure. Community services, infrastructure, and planning, some big items there, Mr. Mayor, and we'll have to talk about them as we go through. So we're talking about 6.97% tax rate increase with regards to potential pressure. As I mentioned, Mr. Mayor, and this is just an update, and Mrs. Collier provided you a good explanation about the 2016. There were transfers within the 2016. Now, in this budget for 2017, two positions, and I've mentioned them to you, brings our budget full-time staff count from 128 to 140. Or 138 to 140, should I say. As you recall, every year, 1% increase in your taxes is $179,200 on the expense or the revenue side. This is an interesting slide, Mr. Mayor. Councillor Lalonde had sent me one from one of the newspapers that had Ottawa, so I decided that I liked the style of it, so I used the same parameters. Fine. So this is very interesting. I have a tax dollar slide, Mr. Mayor, and then I'll show you a spending slide, and there are two different things. Of all of your services, this is how much of them are paid by the tax dollar. So many of the services are paid by user fees. So you'll see, for example, child care at the bottom has nothing. What does that mean? Well, because no taxes in our budget are going to child care. It is fully funded by fees and other services. So when we look at just things that are in the tax dollar, I'll look at the little rectangle first, Mr. Mayor. The city for 2017, an average home at $290,000, you'll pay $1,987 in taxes at 6.97% increase. Garbage at $194. Given a 2.5% increase. County at $1,292 for an average taxpayer of Clarence and Rockland, excluding schools. Schools add on to that average of $3,423. When we put that in the chart, the United Counties, the tax that we amount that we pay is $1,242 for the United Counties of Prescott Russell. Now your corporate services type areas are high, Mr. Mayor, in this chart, because strictly because we don't really have fees or charges. It's all basically on the tax rate. We have very minimal. Capital financing is high, roads and traffic, and then you see each one of them. And this chart is very interesting once you look at others with it, but we don't have the time. It would take quite a while to produce this for other areas, but I think it's an interesting look as to where the average person pays their tax dollar in Clarence and Rockland. Now, that's where you pay your tax dollar. When you look at the spending sign, it just flips over because our biggest spending in our budget is, in fact, childcare at $5.21 million. This is our biggest line item. Capital financing is second. Capital financing, Mr. Mayor, is your debt payment and your pay-as-you-go combined. Then roads and traffic, etc., etc. Water, police. So that's an interest. I like the total spending slide rather than the tax slide, because the total spending is comparing apples and apples. But part of that is paid by county. No, this is the spending side, Mr. Mayor. So it's paid by the counties and it's paid by the users also. So $39.9 million. As Councillor Lalonde had asked last year, we're putting all of these figures together. Not just the city side, but also the water, the sewer, the waste as well. So our total of all of our spending is $39.9, almost $40 million. Now, where do we make that money, $39.9? The big part is on the tax rate, Mr. Mayor, and then you'll see your daycare fees, the province, largely for daycare, water fees, our sewer fees, our waste fees, our other user fees. So we have other user fees, our transit fees, etc. So it's an interesting way of looking at the 2017 budget. Thank you. We're getting close to the end of my time, my presentation, I mean, Mr. Mayor. So 2017 capital budget. You've allowed time for questions, eh? Questions? You have any questions? Oh my, okay, fine. As mentioned earlier, Mr. Mayor, the capital budget is $15.2 million. This is the 2017 capital budget. Joanne was right, yes. 6.9 in debt financing. That's not only tax-supported debt. There's water and sewer. That's all debt. We also have reserve funds of $3.9 million, grants of $2.9 million. We'll talk a bit more of details when you see development charges of 1.3. A pretty healthy capital budget, I'm sure. We'll have discussions on how we're going to pay for it. This is an interesting charge, I think. This line has moved. Yes, it's not in the order of your slides, actually. This actually is slide 25 of the paper copy that you do have. Okay, so we keep talking about our infinite debt limit with the province. So where are we? In 2016, we're at 9.05%. Our net debt charges are $2.5 million. Well, you just saw our lawyers were here, and we just passed a report approving another $11 million in debt. So that's going to impact 2017 by increasing our net debt payments to $3 million for an impact of about 10.73. Now, 2017 doesn't change much. What's happened there, Mr. Mayor, is that we've had reductions in the water and sewer size, offset by increases on the tax rate side. Because in 2018, on the tax rate side, you're going to see an increase in debt of about $110,000 in 2000 as a pressure. Now, this year, you didn't have a debt pressure. Remember, I told you, it's staying stable. We had enough debt room within our debt budget to pay for all of the increases. Now, in 2018, you'll have an increase of approximately $100,000 as a pressure in debt. 2019 is going to be even higher than that, based on the capital program that we presented to you here. So, Mr. Keogh, a question here. I can't recall exactly what you told us a few seconds ago, but you know, Mr. Keogh, I want people to realize, the people that listen, that are not here really, well, that listen to us through the TV, when we took over council in 2014, we had $21 million worth of debt. We lowered it to $20 million in 2015. Right now, we're aiming towards $32 million of debt. I realize that we're getting rid of this and we're doing that. You know, we're still at 10 point some percent, but still, we're still $32 million in debt at the end of 2018 if we go with this budget. You know, I want people to realize that what we're doing tonight and what we'll be doing in the next few years is passing a lot of it along to the future ratepayers. Mr. Mayor, you have to remember that there was a lot of projects approved by previous councils that never got borrowed. So we had to do the borrowing. We had to do a lot of catch-up for borrowing that makes up the $12 million. My intent for council is to do annual borrowings so that we level out, so that we don't go through years without borrowing, and 4 years from now we come out and borrow $16 million. The tax rate cannot deal with that. We want to level out the borrowing so that the impact on the tax rate is gradual, doesn't all hit in 1 year. Yes. Now, Mr. Mayor, and you'll see, Mr. Lalonde, I do have a question. Rob, yes, you say that previous council had a lot of debt and we didn't borrow the money, but someone had to pay those bills. How did those bills get paid in the past? Well, through the bank? Did we rely on banks to do that? Our interest rate must have been pretty high. No, our reserve funds, our cash situation at any point in time. Right now, our bank account, even before we borrowed this $11 million. We already had seven, so we're getting another $5 million. Our bank account, we have about right now, Robert, off the top, 12, well, like we probably have $8 million within our bank account, $8 million right after. So we've got internal reserves that are in our bank account. That's cash. That's cash. That's working capital that we have available to us to refinance all our capital until we permanently. You see, those are only temporary financing mechanisms. All we're doing is repaying our reserves by borrowing money. Well, that's the point, Mr. Mayor. So this is the first year that we've actually borrowed against development charges. In 2016, part of the $11 million that we just borrowed today, $2 million was against development charges because Caron Street has to be paid in cash. There's not enough money in development charges. It's going to be paid over the next 10 years. So what we'll do is that we'll borrow it, place it in there, use it to pay off Caron, and as the monies come in, it replenishes and pays back that debt. So you'll see that development charges are in here, the water and sewer side as well, that are tax supported. And that's where you'll see the water side going down. The sewer side, we just had some water not. And that's providing you some relief on the debt charge because your water side, you're paying off the whole debt. And I think that's it. Yes. So that was it. Were there any other questions on the stuff I presented before I pass it back to Mrs. Collier? Any questions? No other questions? Was that too long or no? All right. Short and to the point. Fine. Fine. So I'm going to talk to you briefly about asset management. And partially that's why I invited Julian Lenhardt to join us. He's dedicated to asset management right now. And he gets to answer the hard questions tonight that you might have. This is part of my mantra that you've heard me talk about from going from good to great. This is one of the critical things that will get us there. As you know, we've had a couple of infrastructure surprises along the way. By having a good asset management system in place, we should not have infrastructure surprises. So we're making progress with asset management now that we've dedicated two staff members to working all day, every day on this project. It is an enormous project. It is a full priority for 2017. Previously we were using three to four different software. Everything will now be in 2017 on one software. We have strict legislation that requires the municipality to have an asset management plan and have an asset management plan that's not sitting on the shelf. It's an asset management plan that we have to look at every month. So we're going to give you a preliminary picture of where we're at, and we're calling it preliminary because there are still fine-tuning that allows us to review all the details of the project. Certainly, Julian has looked at every single project in the city that needs to be worked on and provided his best knowledge and input as to where this project lands in terms of its priority. However, that might change. That may change. Just a little chat about the importance about pay as you go and a quick look at the financial picture and the roadmap. I think we took out for now, and I'll just speak to that. So our roadmap basically is this five-point manner in how to understand and manage our assets. We have a good handle on that now, and the next step of the journey is to start identifying service levels. I'm not going to bore you with all of that tonight. We're going to go back 2017 with service levels in terms of what you want to deliver, what you want to deliver to, well, the level servicing you want to deliver your roads at, when we start to replace sewer pipes, if it's 3 inches, 2 inches thick, or 1 inch thick, how many potholes on the road that you want, 10, 15, or 20 before we replace a road. You know, I'm just making these examples very simple. It's far more complicated than that. We'll be bringing all of that to you this year. Well, that was fancy. All right. So there are two pieces of legislation, of course, that help guide the municipality in having an asset management plan. 2012, Ontario Ministry of Infrastructure has asked municipalities to provide a capital funding plan to match their asset management plan. And then Infrastructure for Jobs and Prosperity, identifies that every municipality shall have an asset management plan. So this chart here just tries to put in perspective for you what the total value of the city's assets are. So the total value is $402 million. So that tells you that we've got to take care of those assets, and we need a funding plan to take care of those assets. So your biggest asset is roads at $148 million, and it's hard to see here on the black and white chart. I'll just run through it very quickly for you. Bridges are at $14 million. Water distribution at 72.8, sanitary sewers at 50.6, storm sewers at 54.8, facilities and parks at 53.7 million, and vehicles and equipment at 7.6. You're going to see those fingers on a table in a minute, but I just wanted to illustrate it in a pie chart for you so you could have a perspective as to where those numbers lie. The important number from this chart is the $402 million of assets. So if we had to go and replace everything that we own today, it would cost us $402 million. Okay, the next chart is the hard one to get our heads around. So you can see in the core assets column the text description, and then we have our total asset value, which adds up to the $402 million. And then I'm talking about the current funding. So this is where the pay-as-you-go contributions come in. For roads, right now, in your base budget, you have $1.1 million that is dedicated under the roads bylaw to fix and repair roads. The water system, we have $680,000. Wastewater, we have $130,000. Buildings, we have $200,000. Fire, fleet, and equipment is in there also. That's $310,000. And then we have grant funding that comes in. That's $1.2 million. Included in that grant funding is the $265,000 that comes from the United Counties. So we have a total dedicated funding envelope of $3,790,000 to help take care and maintain our assets. Julian's worked very hard to project how much we think we need if we want to maintain and take care of our assets in a steady state moving forward. And that's without adding any new assets. We're going to need an estimated $9.1 million. So I'd mentioned to you off and on that we're about halfway there. This is not meant to scare anybody. We're not the only municipality in Ontario that is not funding asset management at 100%. We're not in really bad shape, and that's why this year when we're presenting the $200,000 pay-as-you-go increase, that takes us from, that takes us from our 3.79 to our 4.1 to add in the $200,000 to help augment that contribution to asset management replacement. Yes. Should we not having the actual standing 2016 costs so we can actually judge whether the 2017 increase to $4.1 million is justifiable? Should we not at least know how much we spent on those things? Well, you did spend all of the money. It's what basically is in the capital budget. We may not have finished spending it, but pretty much all of the road improvements that have been done last year are included in that $1.1 million. In the water system, that there were identified works that were done for that amount of money. And certainly in facilities and parks, we spent more than $100,000. So some of the money that we spent will actually be resulting in debt, because this essentially is your capital budget, right? That $3.79 million is money that's invested in the capital budget. I hear what you're asking me, but it is our capital budget from last year, all right? Plus debt, plus other financing. So we spent approximately $12.8 million last year in our capital budget. All right, that's fine. So I could identify projects against those amounts of money, but that $3.79 million was collected from the operating budget last year, funded to capital budget on that capital list of projects. So a lot of those projects were repaired, were repairs and replacements. And so when we bring you the asset management plan this year, we're going to be starting to justify why we need $9.1 million. Okay, and that will come through identifying service levels. Yes. Mrs. Collier? Yes? I'm sorry. That wasn't quite right. Would you? Mrs. Collier? Yes. Mrs. Collier. Debt. $465,000 or $435,000 from the counties. Doesn't that come to an end somewhere, sometime, or is it going to be perennial? Yes, it's going to be. It has been approved for 4 years, and at the end of this year. But this is tax-based room. At the end of the 4 years, the new council of the United Counties will have to decide what to do with that money. So they either give it back to the municipality, or do something else, or keep giving it. This amount of money to the municipality. To make it go away, we would have a tax base reduction. Something has to happen to it at the end of the 4 years. So this existing United Counties Council cannot pre-commit the next council, and at some point they will have to decide what they're doing with that money. There was pressure to take some of that off this year, but the mayors voted against this. It's not going to happen. When the 4 years is up, this is an agreement that it was arrived at for 4 years. Whether it comes back, well, the next council is going to decide upon this. Correct. But it's built in the tax base now. So if they take it out, it's going to create some room. Okay. Now I'm going to run you quickly through some capital projects here. If you look at the 9.1 million amount, yes. Yes, we'll do that. Now, the point of this particular slide is to show that in order to maintain and take care of our assets, we need to keep annually working in a pay-as-you-go contribution basis to pay and replace equipment. Let me take you back to the presentation I gave to you in June on the fleet. Right now, annually, we contribute $290,000 for fleet replacement. That number alone, just to replace our fleet in a timely manner, needs to be $560,000. So we need to keep increasing that at a rate that we can replace our fleet without having serious breakdowns or serious things happen on the road where we'd have surprises. We're trying to avoid those surprises and maintain our infrastructure. I can quite safely tell you from all the presentations I've been to on asset management that there's no one that's fully funded. I know that, yes, at 9.1 million. Because at this rate, we'd be increasing our debt. Or you choose not to take care of some assets or sell off some assets. If I could. So, capital works in progress. We spoke about our 2017 budget, $15.1 million in new projects. The council has stuff in the back, as I mentioned earlier. Projects that are expected to continue beyond 2016, these are capital investments that have been approved. Water, sewer, and tax supported, $16.4 million budget approved. $1.5 million has been spent. Another $14 million to be spent. Now, that $14 million, some of it is coming from reserves, some of it is coming from future debt requirements. Well, the $14 million amount, we'd already are projected to spend that in 2016. We're carrying that over to 2017. Can we ask you a question? Did we not hire project managers last year to pump out all of our projects so that we would not be in this situation? Aside from Saint Joseph, I'd like to know why on earth we're carrying $14 million in unproduced projects. $17.9 million. Well, you'll see the details in your budget book as we go through each of the departments of the capital budget. We'll go through those because the response stems from each director. They have their, well, I remember at about this time last year, I was saying, hey, we have $16 million $17 that we haven't done, and we're adding another $17 million or whatever it is, and we're hearing the same thing again this year. And we have a picture to the effect that it will happen again next year. Well, okay, keep on going. All right, projects to be completed as for 2016, there's another $3.8 million worth of projects to be spent in the next, well, that was the next 4 weeks before the end of 2016. These are going to be completed and off the books. Another $3.8 million for the next 4 weeks. Now, item C, these items are complete from a physical standpoint. The work is complete, but they are not fully financed. So that's about $5.6 million that has to be financed. That's additional debt that we'll be issuing in 2018, at the end of 2018, to finance those projects. Some of those are water. There's a list in your Schedule C. We can go through them. It wasn't presented to you in the past, Mr. Mayor. These are details that a council needs to see. It's taken some time for us to get all the details together, but now the budget is more complete. And you see the entire picture that a council needs to see before they make important decisions. That's why these are works in progress. In your capital budget tab, there are some items that are an interesting read, and I can highlight areas that you can ask your director specifically as to what's happening. Well, you see, the 5.6 that's taken from the reserve, well, most of that is debt financing, the $5.6 million taken from the reserve. Has it been paid so far? Oh, yes, it's been paid out. Everything's paid out. It's been paid out of our working capital, out of our, it's marked down as project completed. Well, it's not permanently financed because we haven't issued debt in this regard yet. It has been paid out from our bank account, but it has not been permanently financed as of yet. So it's a matter of making use of reserves to borrow to contract loans. So the money stems from reserves. Yes, in fact, yes, in fact, yes. It stems from our bank account, which takes into account all of our reserve funds in one fell swoop, all together, if you wish. All right. So the supporting lists for those are paid from 1 through 5 at the beginning of your capital tab. Now, not to panic too much, really. The $16.4 million amount represents the screening project, which is being worked on now. We're doing the engineering. And we, in some cases, require those projects to have the financing approved ahead of time so that we know that we can move ahead with the project. Because if you recall, earlier this year, you approved $500,000 of that $5 million screening project just to do the engineering. Now, in addition, in that list, the other big project that's in there is the fire station, which you know has been delayed a number of times because of the acquisition of the property and a couple of other reasons. So those two projects together are $8 million of that 16.4. Once you review that list, you'll see where that $16.4 million comes from, and the 7.8 and the 4.8 are explained. Mr. Lalonde, we had budgeted last year some items that were not completed. Do we have to pass a bylaw to put that in the reserve to continue on? No, no, you do not. Is it considered a surplus then? Can it be? No. When you approve of a capital program in a given year, you identify the financing for that project. It's approved. When it gets finalized, capital budget is not like an operating budget. It's not held to a fiscal year. Only the capital budget requires you to pass, well, an operating budget item, you'd have to pass a bylaw on to move along. But I would not recommend that we go that route. I recommend if somebody doesn't spend something on the operating side, you lose it and we start fresh. We made a decision that during the course of the other council meeting to put some money from the Canada Day Festival into a reserve fund, and that there was a good business case for it, but quite frankly, I would frown on doing that. It was okay in that case, but for most cases, if you don't spend it, you lose it. You go to next year, it goes to surplus. It goes into our reserves, if you will. But in capital, we're not, you see, in previous years, they did take that money and stick that money aside in those reserve funds. And sometimes those projects got lost. So these amounts of money, we're keeping regular lists and bringing them back to council and saying, you approve those projects, we're still working on them, or some of them have been stalled. St. Joseph is one of those projects that's part of that $16.4 million. We're waiting for the green light to go ahead, and then that $16.4 million amount will come down. Those are the sort of the three big projects that are in there. $5 million for the screen 3.5 for the fire station, and 1.9 for St. Joseph. Okay, so I can skip the details on capital, or I can just give you a high level here that shows you where the $15.2 million is. You have $609,000 in community services, $276,000 in finance, $1.7 million in protective services, $7.8 million in infrastructure and planning, waste, sewer, and water. Is $1.6 million or $4.6 million, should I say, for the 15.2 amount. Now, the next section for Councillor Lalonde. When I look at the finances, legal fees during the year, 216 legal fees. Now, in the 11 months, we've had $244,000 that we've paid out in legal fees. From that, I could take $40,000 off the purchase of the land next to Pilon. But there's still $204,000 that we've paid according to the bill that we've paid. I'm sure there's more than that. Is it not worthwhile to hire a lawyer like they used to have, for example, at one time? You know, they were paying Michael Hull, I believe, $75,000 a year every time that we needed some information or something to be reviewed. Then he was at our disposal, and this is what we were doing. Like tonight, you know, we have to pay for the lawyer's visit here tonight. But we have more than one firm, though. We have three firms that specialize in certain areas. One is real estate. Well, it's hard to find a lawyer that specializes in everything. We don't have a choice. That's the thing. Municipal law has become very complicated, Mr. Mayor, and employment law is even more complicated. Well, I think you get to a certain size and then you can start hiring your own legal agent. Like the City of Ottawa and Toronto would have a legal staff because they do so many of something and they have specialists, but I don't think that we have the economies of scale to warrant this here. Okay, so I've picked some highlighted projects so we can just move into departmental reviews and you can go through the details of each of the capital amounts involved. Let me see, just to speed things up, we need to have a quick look at wastewater and sewer. That's number one. So, for water, our fixed fees will be going up 2%, and consumption will be going up 2%, as we mentioned earlier. Sewer services, the fixed fee is 3.5, consumption is 3.5. And the waste services, the residential fee will be going from $189 to $194. Commercial fee is going from $646 to $707. Question here? I'm pretty sure last year that we discussed the spike of commercial waste that went up 42.6% as opposed to 2016. Now we want to add another 9.5, so we're over 50% really in 2 years. I'm pretty sure that we mentioned that we'd like to have something divided by how much you produce as a business. Are we going to have that this year? Yes, we have a draft report ready for you. And we still have a 9.5 increase planned. Well, I was not satisfied with the content of that report, so we're reworking it and we hope we'll have it back to you early in the new year. Because you see, It's difficult to grow our business side, which is the main source of tax that we want to increase. We heard you on that. Mr. Mayor, if we get a 50% increase in waste for business in 2 years, well, the big Mr. Kehoe, I remember asking you the same thing, and you had an explanation for me as compared to other line items. Well, Mr. Mayor, we're going to be reviewing the whole commercial side of the business, as Mrs. Collier has said. The commercial side, of course, there are some huge inequities on the commercial side right now. That's why I feel we can push more of the fee increase on that side of the business. We're going to rectify that when we provide to council new options for dealing with commercial waste. But Mr. Mayor, we mentioned that last year, that they had 12 months to come up with somewhat of a solution, and now we're facing a 9.5 increase on top of the 42 last year, and we still don't have a solution, or at least something that we can make a decision on as far as what we're going to do. 12 months. I mean, like, even if it was 20%, but we're talking about over a 50% increase, and we want to try and attract businesses in Rockland or investors and businesses in Rockland. If they see that, they're going to say, well, what's going to happen next, you know? I'm in any event. Councillor Lalonde, I agree with Councillor Grimard. In 2 years, the commercial sector is paying more than $300 more a year now. When I look at McDonald's and a lot of places, like the apartment across from Rockland Ford, for example, they have taken another company to pick up the garbage. They don't make use of our garbage pickup company. The apartment building over there and McDonald's, and there are a few more companies that I see progressively hiring public contractors to pick up their waste, their garbage. Well, the policy for new commercial businesses coming into Clarence and Rockland, we do not pick up the garbage. The only businesses we pick up the garbage for are companies that we existed, that we grandfathered into the system. Any new business coming into Clarence and Rockland, we don't touch them, we don't pick up their garbage. We have a report that's been drafted. I know it's been 12 months. It took a lot of research, took a lot of time. It would have been ideal to have it to you in October, which is when I would have liked to have had it to you, but it's not ready to be presented. Well, I'm surprised, however, when I hear the price they were paying. It was unbelievable. They're paying about half. I'm serious. At least one-third, let's say, one-third less than what we're charging. Two-thirds less than what we're charging. Two-thirds less. Apartment buildings you're talking about? Yes, apartment buildings. And just to add to this, I honestly, no matter which comparison you make with another city, and we're trying to catch up, but catching up by over 50% in 2 years, in my opinion, is unbelievable. I'm still surprised that I see an increase this year. I was expecting at least that you would have said, you know, let's leave it at that. We've done 42.6%, I believe, last year. If we tag on another 9.45%, we're going to kill the businesses. They're going to say, you know what? I'm going to go somewhere else. And we're trying to increase our tax revenue base, Mr. Mayor. Well, that's the point of budget discussions, and we'll take that back then. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. All right. The last slide refers to the budget review dates, the 21st of November, 22nd and the 23rd of November, Tuesday and Wednesday of next week, not Monday. That gives staff time to get caught up, so we'll be here on the 29th and the 30th if we would need those evenings. And then Monday, December the 5th, it would be the proposed night to wrap up and approve the tax rate as well as the capital budget. Madam Clerk has had occasion to review the motion that was approved at 6 o'clock. Can you go back to the slides for the December rates to make sure that we're on the same wavelength here? Same page. Yes. All right. All right. I believe that on the 5th of December, we have a regular meeting of Town Council that begins at 6 p.m. We'll be considering at that time adopting the budget at the regular meeting of Town Council next December 5th. Yes, okay. Thank you for that point of clarification. For the clarification, I appreciate it. Now, the Corporate Services Department is the first department to have alluded to budget pressures and protective services neither involve long presentations or discussions. If you have any questions, or we can defer those to, I may have to defer them after the infrastructure because Mr. Darch is only available tomorrow evening. So we will be doing infrastructure tomorrow evening. He won't be available on Wednesday. Do we have a bylaw stating that no meeting shall go past 10:30? Are we assuming that this will actually stop at 10:30 tonight? Yes, we are stopping at 10:30 tonight. Right. Right. That's fine then. Fine. You're getting up early tomorrow morning, are you? No, not necessarily, but we're capping this off at 10:30 tonight. All right. After those big numbers, I'm going to give you some small ones to digest. All right. All right. My figures are too big. So, as Mr. Kehoe explained, my budget falls under... I just want to know which tab we should be referring to in our binder. General Government. And you'll see on the first page, Corporate Services, page 9. So, as Mr. Keogh explained, my budget falls under non-discretionary costs. This slide here, you see, the basis of my budget was kind of restructuring. It involved restructuring, reclassifying different things. Now, the big thing was this. If you take a look at the contribution from the reserve fund, last year there was a contribution from the reserve of $75,000. That was a one-time thing for job evaluations. We're not going to have that this year. The reason why there's a $1,600 amount there is that we started tabbing into the reserve fund for elections. So if you look into this year's expenditures, yes, elections are quite a year or quite a while away, but there are major changes involved with regards to the Election Act, and we're already in training concerning those changes. The clerk and I have attended two training sessions already, and MCTO is proceeding with many more training sessions to be offered next year and the year thereafter. After that, the major amounts that you would see here would... So you see the 16 in and the 16 out as the revenues, income, and expenditures, and the other big item would involve human resources. That's the total of human resources that represents or that includes all of the salary updates and some accounts that we kind of just, well, they were either not included in the last budget and we just added them, such as an example, HR Download, which is a program that we now use, and it was not added until last year's budget. That was added into this year's budget. I'm sorry to interrupt, but we're going down from 2016 to 2017. Yes, because you're taking a look at the income, which is a 74.8, and then the expenditures, then you wind up with a net, yes, of 25, a net. Well, I'm going further down expenditures. Your expenditures have gone down in human resources, correct? Yes, from 42 to 435. Yes. Why do we have such a savings this year in the spending? It's a reclassification of some of the accounts. There's an account of $25,000 that was included in my budget, whereby it should have been included in somebody else's. So right there's a $25,000 savings. So we're just kind of playing with the same money, but reshuffling everything, if you wish. Councillor Simono? All right. Explain to me again elections. The $1,600... What is that now, this expenditure? What, from what I gather, there's already a reserve fund set up that you folks have come up with every year. If I do recall, and correct me if I'm wrong, because I don't know what a real election was would cost, because we had a different election the last time we were here. But it cost something like $90,000 or whatever it is. Anyways, it cost us a fair amount. I thought that each and every year we would set aside a quarter of that amount, which would be put into the reserve. What we're doing this year is that we're advancing a bit of the money to pay for the training that's required because of all of the changes involved in the election. So we're showing a review revenue coming into the reserve fund and the reserves coming out to pay for the training and that Mrs. Charlebois and Mrs. Willett are attending. I guess that, yes. Well, you see, the $25,000 is in corporate. We have all of our contributions in corporate, Mr. Mayor, so that we can see them all in one place. Because annually, you see, the training has been pegged at $5,000. It's an accounting. It's an accounting. That's right. It's an accounting shuffle, basically, from here to there. From 50 Shades of Grey, we've come up to this here. We've wound up with this here. Fine. Yes, yes. No matter what department. No matter what department is involved, the same rule applies. Now, again, the 1600 is in and out. It just takes from the training that we're going to have. This year is basically a summary. $75,000 representing the one-time funding from reserve is taken out. Now, the certificates and the lottery is being put in proportion, reflecting the actual amount of what was there last year. And we noticed also, now, this year, what we wanted to do was this. If we purchased 100 marriage licenses, for example, we would have the revenue for 100 marriage licenses because one should offset the other. Obviously, there's more money coming in than going out, but we don't want to budget for 75 licenses with regards to income and have 100 with regards to expenditures. Now, with regards to memberships and trainings, advertising and conferences, that entails having an extra person attending conferences and memberships and training. Training, or a few employees have asked to receive specific training. And that's about it, really, for my particular budget. Contracts, a $25,000 amount is exactly what was mentioned a while ago. That should not have been put into my budget. It was transferred to somebody else's budget. Mr. Keogh, you see, the $11,000 from that $25,000 has gone over to IT because we're trying to centralize IT costs being paid off out of HR, being put into the IT. That's part of the $51,000 increase in IT. Let's remember that each department has an IT component. Now, yes, eventually we're trying to centralize everything. Yes, yes. Any questions? Questions, questions, questions? Thank you very much, then. All right, so corporate services are done, Mr. Mayor. Let's go on to the next one, then, shall we? All right. You're next, my friend. Who's next? Next. No, not me. Oh, no. Everybody's rushing at the microphone to address council tonight. It's because they just don't want to come back tomorrow night and address us then. Fine. All right, then. The floor is yours, sir. Are we dealing here with protective services? Fine. So, members of town council, we're presenting you with the budget with regards to protective services. Initially, the first set of figures that we see on the screen deals with firefighting services offered. If you take a look at the bottom figures, that reflects the budget. That is tantamount to a 0% increase, really. So the highlights of this particular budget, if we go line by line and item by item with regards to income, no changes. Forecast with regards to income, $103,000. Now, with regards to expenditures, from an administrative standpoint, there are not as many expenditures in the amount of 2%. That's mainly due to the change of administration. A new boss that's going to set up shop in our headquarters in the next few weeks. So the rest represents an increase of 0 or 1% of different expenditures throughout all of our services offered. With regards to salaries, with regards to firefighting, maintenance also of existing buildings and firefighting vehicles and maintenance vehicles. Talk about 0 to 1% increase at most. With regard to emergency management, we're also forecasting a 1% increase. That is tantamount a 0% total increase with regards to firefighting services, in truth. Now, the next page, the next document deals with the Ontario Provincial Police services offered to the population at large. As was mentioned in the past, we're forecasting a 75% or 2% increase, $75,000 increase. Is that based on their new contract that takes its effect, including the back pay? So, 60 grand for the back pay and 75% total increase or 2%. This amount is on page 3. Very little as compared to other municipalities. Mr. Mayor, the OPP each year gave us an estimate as to the increase. So the actuals have come in now. They've always given us a provincial amount. In 2015, they had a provision, and in 2016, they had a provision. When it all comes down to it, the net effect is 60 grand on the 17 budget. Well, thank you then. Now, with regards to bylaw enforcement, income is stable. We have supplementary expenditures of approximately 5% to ensure full servicing, attributable mainly to the fact that we have to contend with more bylaw enforcement officers that are working for us. What was explained earlier on during the course of this particular evening, expenditures concerning Forêt-la-Rose have given rise to changes since the time you've received your initial documents. So income and expenditures concerning Leto's forest patrolling has and expenditures with regard to that line item have been removed from our budget. Mrs. Collier confirms this now. Protective services, including firefighting and bylaw enforcement, amounts to a 2% increase of our total budget. Did you figure all expenditures? I believe we'll receive also invoicing for additional services. Well, we're talking about 20 or some odd thousand dollars or costs that we paid out with regards to a major fire that we last year we hired services from Fire Markey that saves us part of those costs, and depending on the insurance that the farmer had, we might recoup part of the costs involved. Congratulations to you and members of your team. They put in a lot of hours in fighting that particular fire. There was also a fire on St. George Street, was there not, on this coming Saturday? Well, if you'll allow me, Mr. Mayor, this past Saturday we tested out our new firefighters' capacities, and as we were going through a drill, we actually were called upon to combat an actual fire on that selfsame day. Well, let me tell you, it's quite tiring to pull on those fire hoses that are quite heavy. Councillor Simoneau, if I understand correctly. Now, from an operational standpoint, operational budget standpoint, are we questioning items as they are presented to us, or do we, well, are we going to go through every department at a future date? Well, the way the budget is structured, Mr. Mayor, is, well, you see, summaries are contained in each tab and details are in the back. We're not intending to go through any of the details unless council has questions on the details, because we are covering all of the incremental costs, expenses through the summarized documents. I see. I just wanted to mention one thing. Sure. Whenever the table of contents is generated, there are no pages identified with regards to individual items. And even if the pages are identified, they are not in order, in the same order as those pages that appear in the book. I just wanted to mention this. For which budget? Well, for every operating budget, if you look at the table of contents, there are no pages assigned to individual line items. Yes, for the details, right, that's right. And they should have been in the same order as they are mentioned in the initial document. It was a function of time, really. And the operating budget, is it safe to say that it's for the period of ending the 31st of October 2016 and not 2017, as you have it at the top of the pages in the operating budgets? No, the actuals. If you look at the operating budget at the top of every page on the left-hand corner, it says for the period ending the 31st of October 2017. I suppose you mean by that 2016. Yes. Ah, yes. Well, thank you. Well, you're welcome. I have a question concerning conferences and everything. It seems that you guys travel all over North America. All right. I'm just wondering, what are we anticipating conference or training-wise from the fire department? Well, first of all, we're going to have a new chief coming in a few weeks. So we'll discuss with him what he intends us to take as far as training or to attend in conferences. Clarence and Rockland has been involved at the provincial and national level as well. You know, we follow trends and training involved, techniques and everything like that, to be in the know, if you wish, as to what's going on throughout the country. So we do benefit a lot from those conferences, really. But to answer what is planned for 2017, I'll have to sit down with the chief to determine that. It's just, you know, that things are tight. Even when we attend the Good Roads, the mayor gets paid by the counties. You know, we can send two members. And then I see you guys attend a Minnesota conference or wherever. And I'm just wondering, somebody must approve those at one point in time. And it falls upon you, Mrs. Collier, at one point in time to question those particular expenditures. If you're going to squeeze us for who goes to conferences and everything, we're going to do the same everywhere. Yes, of course. Well, thank you then. Fire vehicles. Are we finding new vehicles? Well, it's not planned for 2017, Mr. Mayor. Well, $114,000, is that for repairs? The details would be appearing at the back of the document then? With regard to existing fleet of firefighting vehicles? I thought I'd seen a pumper referenced, or a pumper. Are we talking about the current operational budget? Or the forthcoming one? Well, he's talking about the annual cost of repair. I see. We're going to have to contract out to someone we'll debate this later. I'm just wondering if we needed to set any money aside for this particular purpose, for the maintenance of our firefighting fleet. Anyways, well, come to grips with that subject matter next time around. We'll put this on the agenda next meeting. If I take a look at the capital expenditure budget, Mr. Mayor, fire department, we're looking at the fire hall number one in Bourget, $1.5 million. Fire hall, Bourget based. Just in case, you see, the counties want an ambulance station. If the numbers for operating the station are favorable to us, that's something we would bring to your attention. But we're still awaiting numbers from Prescott Russell. We haven't received anything yet. We've asked a couple of times and not been given any details. If numbers come back to us stating that it's going to cost us money, there's no way we're going to get involved in building this. I'm just thinking that in 2017, we're looking at building a fire station number 3 in Rockland and building fire station number 1 in Bourget. Gee whiz, we're looking at $6 million here. Well, if Prescott Russell wants to pay, and it pays well enough to pay for the building, we might as well go ahead and take advantage of it. But if it's going to cost us 1 or 2% tax increase from our pocket to build over there, it's going to be out of the question. That's it. Or 2% tax is about $400,000, which is not very much. Still, we have to pay it. Yes, ma'am. I'd just like to mention that the Bourget fire station had been planned in the study for 2018. We're showing it in 2017 because the opportunity has come up to partner with the paramedics. We have a piece of land over there. We wouldn't have to buy land. We have a piece of land off Laval. Mrs. Collier, I believe we do have a piece of land in Laval. That's why, you see. Councillor Lalonde, I echo Mr. Simoneau's thinking. They're announcing 650,000 additional expenditures that need to be financed out of the debt. So, at a minimum, we cover that amount. And the other item, now, that's not written in stone. That's not written in stone. This is something that's brought to your attention for information purposes only. If Prescott Russell doesn't come back to us with a favorable response, or just, you know, opening up the door and throwing this out the door. Basically, that's it. All right, the second item here deals with radios, and can you elaborate on this? Yes, our communication system with regards to the radio item has run through its life expectancy. Now, we were involved in a barn fire last week, and our communication system was non-functional, or close to non-functional. We're revamping our communication system right now and making use of digital communication technology. Now, our dispatch system based in Ottawa is now digitally based and will be making use of the same technology now, which will allow us to cover our municipality much better and will be able to afford better protection to our firefighters. Now, this $280,000 expenditure involves the construction of a new tower that will cover St. Pascal, Clarence Point areas where there are communication problems. There's a tower that's also proposed here at the municipal garage, and a new antenna that we're proposing to set up at the Cheney Tower. We'll also be replacing radio units in trucks, portable radio units that individual firefighters carry with them based upon digital technology. Towers also, and what we don't have at present, we don't have a redundancy system. If our tower falls, we have no means of communication anymore. Now, given new technology, if a new tower doesn't function or falls, if we can, this new digital technology will be taking over, and this new equipment will be equipped with individual generators that will ensure continuous communication whether we have power or not. It's going to be more reliable than what we have now. Can you spread that over a 2-year period so that we don't have to pay this out of our debt? Well, let me tell you this. Can we not rent out that communication system? It's possible to rent out such a system, yes, and the technology is ever improving and the costs are ever decreasing. We started looking into this about 2 years ago and the costs have already decreased. If we are to rent this system, I believe it would cost us much less than purchasing the system outright. Yes, at present, the bylaw enforcement services work with this particular type of communication system. That's something we can look into, Mr. Mayor. Mr. Mayor, that would apply some pressure on your operational budget. Well, it will alleviate pressure on our capital expenditures. Well, if it's something that you'll make use of in the future, it's much better to pay for it now, to purchase it outright now, to subject to receiving grants. If I take a look at the ever-changing technology with regard to this, in the span of 8 years, these particular radios won't be functional anymore. We'll have to adopt a new means of communication. It might be wise to rent a new communication system rather than purchase. You see, we wouldn't be compelled to borrow any amount to pay off this project. I don't know if it's strategic. From a strategic standpoint, this could be paid off over a two-year period. I don't think we should borrow for radio systems. We should borrow for industrial park needs or water and sewer. Maybe we can come up with a solution that might jive with what our wishes are, but I'd really be interested in having, well, let's say if it costs us $20,000, $25,000 per year to rent those out, if we're talking about an outright purchase of $380,000 for a new communication system, the radio units take up most of that cost. If we take Mr. Ladone as an example, because you live at the top of the hill, you might have us put up a tower behind in your backyard. It would cost us much less. Mr. Grimaud, would you please accommodate us in that sense? Yeah, I might. Mr. Mayor, we have to look at two things here. We have to make sure that our ratepayers are kept safe, as well as our firefighters. If you don't have any radio, functional radio units, and you can't obtain help, you wind up in a very dicey situation. You have to improve, however, our firefighters' communication system. If we're called upon to purchase this radio unit and pay it off over a two-year period, if we're jeopardizing our firefighters' safety, we're not doing things right. If you could come back with figures, you know, outright purchase as opposed to renting this particular system, that would be fine. Other mayors have looked into renting out communication systems. I see. Mr. Ville, do you have anything else to add? No, that's it. Councillor Lalonde, the pumper, has your department asked for this? Well, yes. There are some firefighting vehicles that fall under the pumper category. Well, if it falls under the protective services component, Mrs. Collier, page 14, item 42. Page 14, item 42. Page 14, item 42, yes. Page 14, 2017 asset budget. Mr. Mayor, last year, all vehicles were included under one department. Town Council had asked that everything be consolidated under one line item. Well, Mr. Mayor, this particular vehicle has been removed from the list. All right. It's all right. Fine. So the we have $400,000 less to contend with. There you go. Fine then. Well, that alleviates about 3% worth of pressure. Would Town Council take a look at work in progress? Well, 5 minutes. If you can make this presentation within 5 minutes, because we shut things down at 10:30. Well, 4 minutes. All right, Finance, Mr. Mayor. It'll take you more than 5 minutes. I can guarantee you that. All right, then. Sorry. Carried. All right, then. All right. This meeting is called over at 10:26. Thank you.